What is going on YouTube? This is Jim, back with another video, and I wanted to do my early impressions of Project Octopath Traveler. Now, unlike a lot of the other bigger reviewers, I did not get a review code. I got the game at launch. I have a job. I have a life. Unfortunately, I can't say I've beaten the game yet, but what I can tell you is that I've logged about 25 hours into it, and I've seen enough of the game to render an early impression, and I wanted to talk to you guys about that, one, while the game is still relevant, and two, so I don't forget it. Later on, I will be doing a much more encompassing final thought video on it, where I'll probably inject some late battle gameplay and some more discussion at that point, but I want to talk about the early stuff now. I also want to indicate that there's not going to really be any spoilers outside anything you've heard. Some of these perspectives may be newer to you than others. Some of them you may have already heard from other reviewers, but it's something that I wanted to do because this game is very near and dear to my heart, and I'd have to say right now it is in my contention for Game of the Year, which, as you guys know, is something that I live for and something that I love thinking about as I play through all of these various experiences. A lot of the criticism about Project Octopath Traveler is about the actual traveling, so to speak. Now, to put this in context for you guys, I grew up playing Nintendo, Super Nintendo RPGs. I love Final Fantasy II, Final Fantasy III, Final Fantasy VII, so on and so forth. And the thing that those games always did so well was conveyed so much with so little. And we didn't have full-blown CGI back then. All we had was text boxes and very basic sprites. Sometimes the sprites could wave their hand, they could kneel, they could turn around, they could stand next to each other. Really limiting on what you could do, and it was important to take the language and the dialogue that you had in conjunction with the sprites, in conjunction with the background music, and try to convey emotion in a way that was meaningful when you're only reading lines of text at a time. Not reading huge novelizations, you're using your imagination to fill in most of, if not all of, the inflection and the, you know, veracity of the way somebody speaks or the emotion in their voice. And Project Octopath Traveler has absolutely nailed that. Now, the game does have some parts that you read and some parts that are actually voice acted. And the parts that you read don't matter as much. Now, yes, I would have loved to have the whole game voice acted. For whatever technical or memory limitations of putting a game on a game cartridge or budget reasons, I'm not sure why the guys elected to do that, but they did. The parts that you read are the side stories or the filler leading up to the main pivotal moments in a character's path in their traveling adventures. And when you read them, they do a good job of kind of setting up the story. A lot of times you'll kind of blow through them in anticipation of the dialogue, which I think is a detriment to the system. But it's not something that reading really takes away from, and it's something that, you know, is more of a filler. And these JRPGs, unfortunately, do have a lot of filler because when you really break down what the true game mechanics are, there's really not a lot to them. So having these long NPC dialogue conversations with the random villagers in town, or getting a side quest, or reading through when you interrogate a character with Alfwin or somebody else, and I'll talk about that later, reading that long dialogue, it doesn't matter as much whether it's voice acted or not. When you get to the part that matters, when the major story points are happening, the game shifts to voiceover, and they do an amazing job. And between the music that's playing in the background, whether it's silent or a character's music or some combination thereof, plus the way they position their sprites, you know, just a small step forward towards the direction of another character talking could mean confrontation, it could imply camaraderie, it could imply a lot of different things. And they do a good job with the sprites, the way they're positioned, to really frame a scene, to really kind of express that. Now, I don't know if it's because I've been going to a lot of plays with my wife, and I'm starting to become more familiar with how a theater is presented, but that's really the way that I kind of interpreted the game. And I really kind of saw the framing and the pacing of where characters were on the shot to kind of give you a better indication of who's important in the scene, what's central, what's not, what little movements are going on in the periphery, may or may not matter, may or may not be filler. And I appreciate that a lot. And I think that alone, if you're just talking about the kind of the presentation. I'm not talking about the 2D HD stuff. I'm talking about the presentation of the characters' emotions, the way they're conveyed. It really trumps some of the fully rendered, you know, Halo 5 full CGI motion scenes in a game where they really went all in on technology. I think breaking it down into simple sprites and simple movement patterns and very simple dialogue sometimes actually tells more of a story. The fact that you can't see their facial expressions and you're just reading text and listening to the music for contextual clues, seeing how they're positioned on the grid against other characters, sometimes actually does a better job than that full-blown Hollywood effect. And I think that's something that has really been overlooked in this game, and that's one of the reasons why I feel it is a Game of the Year contender. The music is another absolutely jaw-dropping experience. And, you know, I don't know how many of you guys have Super Nintendo classics or remember the old games, but there are a lot of classic songs that came out of that Super Nintendo era with that with that sound chip that they had at the time. Music like The Dark World and Legend of Zelda, or anything from Secret of Mana. I mean, there are a lot. Into the Thick of It from Secret of Mana as the one I'm thinking of. Such an iconic song. Terra's theme from Final Fantasy, or Locke's theme. Music that you just don't forget. The Chocobo sound, right? I mean, these are music files. These are blips of sound that are absolutely iconic to this day, that have been recreated by full orchestras, that have been recreated by people playing guitar or violin at home on their computer and uploading these and getting millions of views. These are songs that are in your heart, okay? Octopath Traveler has such a rich, iconic library of unique sounds. It really frames the game in a way that I haven't seen done in many other games. And as much as I loved God of War, that soundtrack is almost entirely forgettable. You look at Octopath Traveler and you think of the music. The fact that the fight music changes as you start leveling up, as you get harder, the music actually changes, not just the standard fight music throughout the game. The character's music, the way it interlaces with the area you're in, the town you're in, the crisis you're going through with each character, really paints such a vibrant picture to these memories that you start to form. And I feel like this will be one of those soundtracks that is going to be those iconic soundtracks that in 10, 15 years, we're going to be talking about some of the great music that we heard, because it's just going to stay with us. And I feel like attention to detail on that is so pivotal. And it's something that has really been overlooked. And for that reason, I would say this game is an absolute Game of the Year contender. So you have two different reasons now that's why I'm saying, to me, this game is starting to frame itself as a Game of the Year contender. The plots are really, really riveting too, and I know there's been a lot of controversy about why aren't the characters talking to each other? You know, we're supposed to be on a party, and you know, you got to understand from the classic JRPG standpoint, it was all the characters versus the big bad at the end, and they allied together, and through their strengths and weaknesses and trials and tribulations, they became greater than their parts, and they became this unstoppable force to, you know, Final Fantasy to go fight Zeromus on the moon, or, you know, in Final Fantasy III to stop Kefka's dark reign. And these are games that had villains and heroes that needed to kind of work to each other, because not that they were bland by any sense of the imagination, but their individual story arcs weren't all that developed. You think of like Kane from Final Fantasy. He was probably the most dynamic character of the entire game because he was good, he was bad, he had conflictions with Cecil and Rose's relationship, he, you know, didn't know how he belonged, he was easily manipulated, he felt guilty about it. That was a very complex storyline. But you look at storylines like Palom and Porom, for example, just very kind of throwaway NPCs that just had very one simple note to them, you know. And it's hard to say that they could have stood on their own. I feel Octopath Traveler's stories, each of those stories, are riveting in their own way. They are framed very well with high-level narrative. The NPCs that support them actually matter. The story that they're doing is their story to tell. Primrose the Dancer, the first character we picked, and we're still playing with her story. We just finished the second chapter. A dancer, basically a prostitute, who is working at a bar as a prostitute, selling herself, waiting to just get information on the man that killed her father. One of three men that, you know, was responsible for killing her father. And her story arc goes from this kind of an exterior, this sweet, beautiful dancer who, you know, very charming and alluring. She's a snake. She is out for vengeance. And I don't want to spoil anything, but she takes a very dark path. I don't necessarily care what Cirrus, the philosopher, or Olberic, the knight who is down on his luck, or Theron, the thief who's been tricked. I really don't care what their thoughts are on Primrose's adventure. It's her story to tell. So yes, from a gameplay mechanic, it is a little weird when Primrose gets on a caravan by herself and, you know, tries to go to a manor to sell herself in hopes of finding, you know, one of these big villains that she's been hunting down. And then suddenly the other three characters in your party show up. It's like, well, how did they get on the caravan? Wouldn't anybody be like, why is that knight sitting there? I thought we were going to get together and have fun later, Primrose, right? I get that. There are some mechanics that don't make perfect sense because of that, but I don't think that matters. I don't think the game is selling itself on that, and I don't think that that's something that the game really needs to expand upon. It's a mechanic to, you know, build up the party so that the fighting isn't so stale. Fighting with Primrose against everybody in a turn-based game would be absolutely boring and horrendous. You need other characters to flesh out that party system. And there are some moments, depending on who's in your party, where you can kind of do a little bit of chatting with each other. And they do give each other light words of encouragement, but they're basically all in agreement that, like, yeah, you know what, Primrose? I stand behind you. I support you. And it's not a lot of give and take. It's usually, you know, maybe like five or six sentences between each little chapter to just kind of like, hey, I support you. Thanks. And then they might make a little bit more, you know, personality might be injected in there, like Alfin, who's like, you know, Primrose, there's a lot of pretty girls and beer over there. Maybe we should go hang out. And she's like, Alfin, we need to stay on track. And he's like, oh, okay, you're right, Primrose. Or Olberic, a strong knight, is like, you know what? Sometimes going forward, you know, headstrong isn't the best tactic. That's what I would do, but I support your decision. That's all the interaction I need. I don't need Olberic to inject himself into Primrose's story, or anybody's story for that matter, other than his own. And I feel that that's really been missing from the reviews, and it's something that's been frustrating me, because the truth is, this is eight individual stories, and it's framed that way. You don't have to get all the characters to see Primrose's story through. If you're really hardcore, you could probably beat it on your own with just her and never get anybody else. It'd be really painful, but you don't need to understand what everybody else's involvement is with each other. And I think that that's really been overlooked by the press, and I think the game's gotten slightly of a slight bad rap because of that, and it's something that I'm not particularly thrilled about. So those are the three positives to me that really make this game stand out as game of the year. Now, some of the other monotonous things that you do, like I mentioned Alf when interrogating everybody in the town to get information to find hidden treasures, or Theron stealing from people, or Olberic challenging people to knock them out to go through doors. That does get stale, and I think the pacing does suffer from that. And I'm not going to pretend that the game doesn't have pacing issues, because it does, but I think that the goal of the game and the end drive of seeing your favorite character or character's story to the end, I think it trumps all that. I think when you look at some of those kind of throwaway filler mechanics, I think when you look at the pacing and the framing, when you look at the sound music, sound design, and when you look at the individual tales that each character is telling, I think that it's more about that end destination than some of the nonsensical stuff you're going to do in every town that is going to kind of fade away. And truth be told, you look back at the classics, as I've been mentioning, like Final Fantasy II and Final Fantasy III, there are a lot of places and a lot of characters you meet that you probably just don't remember anymore that didn't make a big impact on you. And yes, each town has a different design, and you can go to the inn, you can go to the, you know, blacksmith and buy new gear and sell your old gear and yada, yada, yada. That doesn't matter. It's those epic moments. It's those jaw-dropping story points. It's when the characters you think you know are not who they seem to be. It's when that music hits at just the perfect time that just gives you goosebumps. It's like, wow, that was a very epic moment. The way that was framed, the way that that story point was told to me, that really was something that inspired me personally. To me, those are the moments that make this game stand out, that make this game of a year contender. But I can't give it a score yet. I'm still very early on. I know 25 hours sounds like a lot, but in a JRPG, it's just not. And if that turns people off, I understand. This game is an absolute love letter to people like me who grew up on those games, grinding the original Final Fantasy and Ultima Warrior, or Dragon Warrior and Ultima Online. I get it. It's not for everyone. But I don't want people to be, you know, dissuaded by some of the reviews, even though they are generally positive and the game is trending fairly high in Metacritic. I constantly see these story points overlooked. And I love the game so much. It does mean something to me. Talking about it, I do feel a certain way about it, obviously overwhelmingly positive, but I felt like I had to do a video to just talk. And if you made it to the end, it's about 16 minutes here when I'm all said and done. Good for you. Thank you guys so much for indulging me a little bit on some JRPG fanboyism. There's definitely a lot of it in spades. And if you have a Nintendo Switch, I highly recommend you guys check this out. And I would argue that this could be a system seller for people who don't have one. I think this is a game that is going to be talked about for a long time and probably fairly emulated, particularly in some of the storytelling mechanics, but definitely, definitely in terms of the music. I would not be surprised if somebody much smarter and wiser than I put together some sort of concert playing this music live. I would be their front row center. As always, I want to thank you guys so much for watching. I will do a follow-up video to this. I'll link it back to this video. It's probably going to be a couple weeks, maybe months before I get through it. I have quite a backlog of games between myself and my wife traveling for work. We can't play it as much as we want to, but when we do get around to it and I do beat it and the final curtain has dropped, I will come back to it and do a late to the party final review. As always, I want to thank you guys so much for watching, and until next time, I will see you guys on the other side.